साहब ने बता ही दिया है कि वो ज्यादा एक्सप्लेन करने की जरूरत नहीं है, आप तो बहुत मानस्ती हैं तो मैं आपका बहुत स्वागत करता हूँ। इसके अलावा जितने भी मेंबर आज के इस वेबिनार में हमारे साथ जुड़े हुए हैं, मैं पानीपत ब्रांच की मैनेजमेंट कमेटी की तरफ से उनका भी बहुत शुक्रिया अदा करता हूँ और इसी तरह आशा करता हूँ कि आप हमें अपना रेगुलर सहयोग देना जारी रखेंगे। थैंक्स टू ऑल।
थैंक यू सर। थैंक यू सुरेश सर, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद वर्ती चेयरमैन ऑफ द पानीपत ब्रांच। और सर की इतनी ग्रेट पर्सनैलिटी देखते हुए हमने सोचा सर से रिक्वेस्ट किया कि सर अगर हम कंसेप्ट में जाएंगे तो हम वो नॉलेज नहीं ले पाएंगे जो नॉलेज आप डिलीवर करने में एक्सपर्ट हैं, जो प्रैक्टिकल नॉलेज जो आप कोर्ट में आर्ग्यूमेंट करते हैं। तो सर से रिक्वेस्ट किया कि सर प्रैक्टिकल एस्पेक्ट बेनामी लॉ, एंट्री मनी लॉन्ड्रिंग लॉ, आप इन दोनों के सर कवर करें। ये हमारी आपसे हम्बल रिक्वेस्ट ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ ऑल द मेंबर जो ज्वाइन है। अगर बीच बीच में कोई कंसेप्ट का इश्यू आएगा तो वो भी सर आप डील कर लें। आपका थोड़ा सा लुक चेंज हो गया सर, मत स्टाइल और नॉलेज आपका और इम्प्रूव हुआ है। तो वंस अगेन वेलकम यू सर एंड ओवर टू यू सर।
थैंक यू भूपेंद्र जी फॉर द काइंड वर्ड्स। सुरेश भाई, आई एम रियली थ्रिल्ड टू बी अमंगस्ट यू। रादर आई शुड बी प्रिविलेज्ड टू से दैट पानीपत ब्रांच हैज इनवाइटेड मी टू शेयर माय थॉट्स। और सर सोनीपत पानीपत से तो पुरानी यादें जुड़ी हैं, आपको शायद पता नहीं मेरी वाइफ सोनीपत से हैं और पानीपत में मेरे फादर इन लॉ रहे हैं, तो इसलिए कैसे मना कर सकते हैं साहब। इज ए प्रोफाउंड प्रिविलेज। और जो आप ये सब बातें कर रहे हैं प्रोफाइल के, सर कुछ नहीं है, आई एम बस जस्ट वन ऑफ यू। रादर आई एम थ्रिल्ड टू एड्रेस ए एनलाइटेंड गैदरिंग ऑफ ऑल द चार्टर्ड अकाउंटेंट्स, सो इट इज माय प्रिविलेज रादर। और जैसा आपने कहा कि फंडामेंटल्स, दो फंडामेंटल्स आर वेरी एसेंशियल, बट फंडामेंटल पे मुझे लगता है कि मैं काफी सारे, चूंकि मेरी डेलीब्रेशन हो चुकी हैं तो फंडामेंटल कहीं ना कहीं सभी लोगों ने कुछ ना कुछ सुना होगा, तो इसलिए मैंने सोचा कि उन्हें एक प्रैक्टिकल ओरिएंटेशन पे आज मैं कुछ बोलूं यहाँ पर। और फंडामेंटल कोई इशू आएगा तो ऑफकोर्स वो भी हम रेज कर सकते हैं, बट हम फंडामेंटल बोलते हैं तो ज्यादा अच्छा रहेगा। फंडामेंटल पे हम उसको पिकअप करते हैं, फंडामेंटल पे बहुत ऑफकोर्स अच्छा रहेगा, लेकिन अगर हम प्रैक्टिकल पे बोलेंगे तो आपको कनेक्ट कर पाएंगे आप चीजों से। और जहां जहां फंडामेंटल पे आपको लगेगा कि मेरे को रुकने की या कुछ कहने की जरूरत है, आई विल ऑफकोर्स आई विल एक्सप्लेन दैट ऑल्सो, वट एवर थॉट्स आई हैव ब्रॉट। तो चलिए शुरू करते हैं ऑन दिस टूर ऑफ बेनामी लॉ एंड पीएमएलए। अब ये दोनों ही टॉपिक अपने आप में काफी बड़े और विस्तृत टॉपिक हैं, तो जब भूपेंद्र जी ने कहा कि साहब आपको दोनों टॉपिक पे बोलना है, तो मैंने सोचा यार दोनों टॉपिक पे कैसे बोला जाए एक साथ, क्योंकि हर एक में ही अपना अपना इंडिपेंडेंट टाइम लगेगा, हाफ ऑफ डे हर एक में लग सकता है। तो देन भूपेंद्र जी का, नहीं एक काम करते हैं, जितना आपको ठीक लगे थोड़ा थोड़ा दोनों का आप हमें एक मिक्सचर दीजिए। तो मैंने एक ऐसा ही एक बुक तैयार किया है जिसमें कि दोनों को मैंने थोड़ा थोड़ा डाला है, और उसके जो आए दिन जो एस्पेक्ट्स हम फेस करते हैं उन सारे एस्पेक्ट्स को मैं आके टेकअप करता हूँ। अच्छा एक चीज बताइए सर कि इसमें सिचुएशन क्या है, कि यहाँ पर नोटिस वगैरह आ रहे हैं पानीपत में, सीन क्या है?
अभी सर शुरू नहीं हुए सर।
अच्छा कोई नोटिस नहीं आया पानीपत से, कोई बिनामी यूनिट का नोटिस नहीं आया, किसी करनाल से भी नहीं आया?
अभी सर शुरू नहीं हो रहा, अगर आया भी होगा तो वो शायद दिल्ली वाले कोई प्रोफेसर को डील कर रहे होंगे।
अच्छा चंडीगढ़ से आते होंगे, आपकी बीपीयू कौन सी लगती है?
चंडीगढ़ में तो सर काफी आ रहे हैं सर।
आपकी जो बेनामी प्रोहिबिशन यूनिट है वो चंडीगढ़ लगती है?
चंडीगढ़ लगती है सर हमारी।
हाँ तो चंडीगढ़ से तो बहुत नोटिस आए हैं, काफी सारे केसेस हम भी कर रहे हैं। चंडीगढ़ यूनिट इज वेरी एक्टिव, जो वहाँ ऑफिसर है आजकल, शी इज वेरी एक्टिव, शी हैज इशूड मेनी नोटिसेस, इवन इन लॉकडाउन शी हैज बीन फॉलोइंग विद द नोटिसेस, रिप्लाईज एंड ऑल दैट। तो मतलब जब तक, जब नोटिस आना शुरू होगा उसके बाद तैयारी करने की बजाय पहले से तैयारी की जाए, उससे अच्छी बात और क्या होगी। सबसे पहले मैं अपनी वो जो पीपीटी है वो शेयर करता हूँ, अगर आप शेयर स्क्रीन का मुझे वो दें तो।
जी सर,
अगर अभी छोटा नजर आ रहा हो तो हम अपने सब वीडियो बंद कर देते हैं, फिर पूरा नजर आएगा।
नहीं सर, परफेक्ट परफेक्ट दिख रहा है सर।
ओके तो न्यू बेनामी लॉ, वी विल बी टचिंग द एस्पेक्ट्स ऑन बेनामी लॉ, और उसके बाद हम बात कर सकते हैं एंटी मनी लॉन्ड्रिंग लॉ की, SFIO की, या जिसका भी इसके साथ इंटरप्ले होता हो, या इनकम टैक्स की। तो अगर हम बेनामी लॉ की बात करें तो बहुत सारे क्वेश्चन तुरंत हमारे माइंड में उठते हैं आज कि बेनामी लॉ जो है ये क्या है, नया लॉ आया है या पुराना लॉ है, अगर नया है तो क्या रिट्रोस्पेक्टिवली अप्लाई होगा, रिट्रोस्पेक्टिव अप्लाई होगा तो कौन सी डेट से होगा, पुराने कब तक के ट्रांजेक्शन कवर हो सकते हैं, सारे ट्रांजेक्शन कवर हो जाएंगे क्या। दूसरा क्वेश्चन ये आता है कि चलिए पुरानी रिट्रोस्पेक्टिव तो छोड़िए, प्रोस्पेक्टिवली कहाँ तक अप्लाई होगा, कि आज अगर किसी ने कोई ट्रांजेक्शन किया, आज मान लो कोई किसी ने लैंड ली, तो कब तक उसको उसके ऊपर एक्शन लिया जा सकता है, क्या उसकी कोई समय सीमा 3 महीने, 6 महीने, 1 साल, 2 साल, 10 साल, 20 साल, या लाइफ टाइम में कभी भी उसको डिस्टर्ब कर सकते हैं, या इवन उसकी लाइफ टाइम के बाद उसके चिल्ड्रन, ग्रैंड चिल्ड्रन को भी आके कह सकते हैं कि तुम्हारे जो फोर फादर्स प्रॉपर्टी छोड़कर गए थे, ये प्रॉपर्टी नहीं है, लायबिलिटी है, हमें दे दीजिए, कोई समय सीमा है क्या, तो क्या इनकम टैक्स अगर पे कर दिया है तो क्या उस ट्रांजेक्शन को भी बेनामी में ले सकते हैं, दोनों पे बेनामी, इनकम टैक्स भी पे करना पड़ा और बेनामी में प्रॉपर्टी चली भी गई, क्या इसमें इंटेंशन का कोई स्कोप है, कि मान लीजिए जेन्युइनली मैंने अपनी मदर के नाम से या फादर के नाम से प्रॉपर्टी ले ली तो क्या वो भी बेनामी डिक्लेयर हो सकती है, क्या इसमें सिर्फ जायदाद आती है यानी कि मूवेबल प्रॉपर्टी आती है, जमीन जायदाद, या इसमें मूवेबल प्रॉपर्टीज भी आती हैं, क्या ये सिर्फ पब्लिक सर्वेंट्स के लिए है जो कहा गया था जब लाए थे, या बिजनेस एंटिटीज को भी ये हिट कर रहा है, क्या ये अर्बन लोगों के लिए है या रूरल लोगों के लिए भी है, यानी कि एग्रीकल्चर लैंड पे भी लगेगा क्या, और रूरल ट्रांजेक्शन उन पे भी लगेगा क्या, रूरल असेट्स जो होती हैं क्या उन पे भी लगेगा, या सिर्फ अर्बन सिटीज के लिए है, क्या इसमें यू टर्न की कोई गुंजाइश है, क्या ऐसा कुछ है इसमें कि अगर कोई चाहे कि साहब मेरे से गलती से ट्रांजेक्शन हो गया तो मैं इसको वापस कर लेता हूं, क्या कोई कंपाउंडिंग की गुंजाइश है, इस तरह के बहुत सारे सवाल हमारे दिमाग में उठ रहे हैं, और बिलीव मी आप जो भी गेस कर रहे होंगे आंसर ठीक उसका अपोजिट मिलेगा, तो इसलिए इस लॉ को जानना बहुत जरूरी है। और मैं अक्सर कहता हूँ ये बेनामी लॉ इस तरह की चीज़ आई है कि इससे सिर्फ हम लॉ ही नहीं समझते, इससे हम लाइफ कैसे जीनी है ये भी समझते हैं, सो हाउ टू लिव लाइफ उसको भी समझने में हमारे को ये मदद करता है। आपको हो सकता है अचंबा हो रहा हो पर ये बात सच है, क्योंकि बहुत सारे फंडामेंटल्स कुछ ऐसे क्लियर होते हैं कि लगता है कि यार वाई टू लिव बेनामी लाइफ, गेट रिड ऑफ बेनामी लाइफ एंड लिव रियल लाइफ। चलिए आगे बढ़ते हैं। इसके अलावा मैं एक बात और जरूरी जो है कहना चाहता हूँ कि अब बहुत सारे लॉज इस तरह के सरकार लेकर आई है जो कि इकोनॉमिक ऑफेंसेस को डील करते हैं, जो इसलिए लाए गए हैं कि इकोनॉमी को क्लीन किया जा सके, स्ट्रीमलाइन किया जा सके, और इसलिए ये कानून लेके आया गया है। अब चूंकि नए नए कानून आ गए हैं और उसकी नई नई परेशानियां हैं, और सिर्फ नए नए कानून ही नहीं आए हैं, कुछ इस तरह की चीजें भी आई हैं कि उन सारों कानूनों का आपस में एक स्ट्रॉन्ग इंटरप्ले है, यानी कि एक वायोलेशन किसी एक लॉ में वो दूसरे लॉ को भी हिट करती है, चूंकि वो दूसरे लॉ को भी हिट करती है इसलिए जरूरी है कि हम उसको अच्छे से समझें कि वो है क्या, कि ऐसा ना हो हम भले ही उस दूसरे लॉ में प्रैक्टिस नहीं कर रहे हो तो सोल्यूशन एक में देने लगे लेकिन बाकी में जबरदस्त प्रॉब्लम खड़ी हो जाए। तो स्ट्रॉन्ग इंटरप्ले सिर्फ कानून में नहीं है, अब एजेंसीज में ही कोऑर्डिनेटेड एक्शन होना शुरू हो गया है, और किस कानून का दायरा क्या हो सकता है ये अंदाजा लगाना बड़ा मुश्किल हो गया है, जो कि आप इससे आपको थोड़ा अंदाजा लगेगा। ये स्लाइड मैंने आपके सामने रखी है कि दो चिंपैंजी हैं ये, इनको अटैच किया है किसने, एनफोर्समेंट डायरेक्टरेट ने। तो आप भी सोच रहे होंगे इन द सेम मैनर एज आई वॉज अम्यूज व्हेन आई रेड दिस न्यूज इन हिंदुस्तान टाइम्स कि यार ये चिंपैंजीज एंड अटैचमेंट बाई ईडी, ये क्या बात हुई, इसमें क्या कनेक्ट हुआ। यस, कनेक्ट है और बड़ा जबरदस्त कनेक्ट है। आपको ये मालूम होगा कि ईडी का जो पूरा काम है यानी कि पीएमएलए में जो भी जितने भी एक्शन होते हैं उसके लिए जरूरी है कि पहले कोई शेड्यूल्ड ऑफेंस हुआ हो, क्राइम हुआ हो, उसके बाद ईडी का रोल आता है। तो अगर हम शेड्यूल्ड ऑफेंस की बात करें तो शेड्यूल्ड ऑफेंस की लिस्ट बहुत लंबी है जो उसमें दी हुई है लिस्ट, और उस लिस्ट में एक नाम वाइल्ड लाइफ प्रोटेक्शन एक्ट के वायोलेशन का भी है। तो अगर वाइल्ड लाइफ एक्ट के प्रोटेक्शन किसी वाइल्ड लाइफ प्रोटेक्शन एक्ट का कोई वायोलेशन किसी ने किया हो तो ये माना जाएगा कि उसने शेड्यूल्ड ऑफेंस किया है पीएमएलए में। तो किसी सज्जन ने, अब उसे सज्जन कहेंगे क्या कहेंगे, उन जनाब ने इसको कोई सर्टिफिकेट फोर्ज किया और ये वाइल्ड लाइफ प्रोटेक्शन एक्ट का वायोलेशन किया और ये चिंपैंजीज एक्वायर किए। अब ये बात ईडी तक पहुंची तो अब चूंकि शेड्यूल्ड ऑफेंस किया है उन्होंने और उस शेड्यूल्ड ऑफेंस से ये जो चिंपैंजी उसको मिले ये उसकी प्रोसीड्स हैं, तो ये प्रोसीड्स शेड्यूल्ड ऑफेंस से मिले हैं जिसको कि वो ये क्लेम कर रहा है कि वो शेड्यूल्ड ऑफेंस से नहीं है, तो लॉन्ड्रिंग भी हो गई। तो लॉन्ड्रिंग में प्रोसीड्स भी हो गई, प्रोसीड्स भी हो गई, क्राइम भी हो गया. तो ये ईडी कैन अटैच सच प्रॉपर्टीज ऑल सच प्रोसीड्स ऑफ क्राइम विच आर डिराइव्ड फ्रॉम कमीशन ऑफ शेड्यूल्ड ऑफेंसेस. अच्छा, कुछ सज्जन लोग सर्कल बना रहे हैं, आई थिंक एनोटेशंस को वो करना पड़ेगा, डिसेबल पार्टिसिपेंट्स एनोटेशन. ये जरा पता भी लग जाएगा कि कौन एनोटेशन कर रहा है, नेम्स भी आ जाएगा, शो नेम्स ऑफ एनोटेटर्स. तो अब इसको रेस कैसे किया जाए, अभी सर्कल परमानेंटली बना रहेगा जब तक हम इसको रेस करते हैं.
ये पार्टिसिपेंट ने किया सर?
हाँ जी बिल्कुल, मैंने अब तो कर दिया, आ गया अब तो. हाँ, कर दिया
ठीक
है. अब मैंने डिसेबल कर दिया अब तो.
ठीक है सर,
आप तो डिसेबल कर दिया, आप नहीं कर पाएंगे, और करेंगे तो नाम आ जाएगा सामने. अब तो ये इस तरह से ईडीज ने अटैच कर ली चिंपैंजीज. अब देखिए कितना वाइड कनेक्ट हो गया, हम इमेजिन भी नहीं कर सकते थे कि इस तरह से चिंपैंजीज जो है अटैच किए जा सकते हैं ईडी के द्वारा. आगे बढ़ते हैं थोड़ा सा. ये न्यूज आपने शायद पढ़ी हो इकोनॉमिक टाइम्स में, दैट मोदीज बेनामी लॉ हैज कंपनीज रनिंग फॉर कवर. इनफैक्ट बहुत सारी प्रॉपर्टीज अटैच हो गई हैं, देखिए कई आपके सामने खुला हुआ है, ऑल ओवर इंडिया कितनी प्रॉपर्टीज अटैच हुई हैं, एंड फॉर मेनी रीजंस आर इनॉर्मस. ये इतना सोचा भी नहीं था, इमेजिन भी नहीं किया था कि इतनी सारी प्रॉपर्टीज अटैच हो सकती हैं. तो आज पानीपत से भी हो सकता है नोटिस नहीं आए हों, लेकिन पूरे देश भर में एक बहुत बड़ा सवाल और भी बहुत बड़ा बवाल बना हुआ है इस जो बेनामी लॉ में जो एक्शंस हो रहे हैं उसकी. देन ये न्यूज मुझे काम की लगी इसलिए मैं आपके साथ शेयर कर रहा हूँ. सीबीआई ईडी एक्शन में नाउ फॉलो आईटी डिफॉल्ट प्रोब्स. सो मल्टी एजेंसी स्क्रूटनी हैज बीन डिसाइडेड एंड it has been decided that all these agencies will work in tandem with each other. They will work hand in hand. They will share the data. They will share their actions. They will share their intelligence and work in a coordinated environment. And for that, inter-ministerial task force has also been created. And special section has been created under PMLA that is called as Section 72A for this purpose only. So the government is keen and is really working, I mean, with such an at such an advanced level. So therefore, it is essential that we, while doing practice under income tax law or GST, should also have awareness of other laws so that we can gauge the problem and we can guide the clients properly, that they should not land themselves into trouble by doing something illegal or making any violation knowingly, unknowingly. Then अभी एक जो बहुत बड़ी बात आज सामने आती है वो आती है इंटरप्ले की, कि इनका आपस में इंटरप्ले क्या है. तो आज जिस तरह से मैंने अभी बताया कि कानून इस तरह से बनाए कि हर एक कानून दूसरे से जुड़ गया है, और कहीं वायलेशन एक में होता है और उसकी जो इफेक्ट है वो चार जगह पांच जगह जाता है. जैसे बेनामी लोग का सीधा सीधा जो आज कंसर्न है इनकम टैक्स एक्ट से है, कंपनीज एक्ट से है, सेबी रेगुलेशन से है, और एंटी मनी लॉन्ड्रिंग लॉ से है. कंपनीज एक्ट में अभी एक नया जो बदलाव आया है उसमें सिग्निफिकेंट बेनिफिशियल ओनरशिप कॉन्सेप्ट आई है, जिसमें कि कंपनीज आर रिक्वायर्ड टू रिपोर्ट द डिटेल्स एंड पर्टिकुलर्स ऑफ दो शेयर होल्डर्स हु मे नॉट बी रजिस्टर्ड शेयर होल्डर्स इन द कंपनी बट हु हैव एक्चुअल कंट्रोल ओनरशिप कंट्रोल ओवर द शेयर्स ऑफ द कंपनी. सो उसको बोलते हैं सिग्निफिकेंट बेनिफिशियल ओनर. तो अगर उस तरह का कोई डिस्क्लोजर आता है तो उस तरह के ट्रांजेक्शन सीधा सीधा बेनामी लॉ में भी हिट हो सकते हैं. और मनी लॉन्ड्रिंग में तो एंटी मनी लॉन्ड्रिंग लॉ में तो जब कोई दूसरे नाम से ट्रांजेक्शन करता है तो बेनामी लॉ में हिट होगा ही होगा. तो इस तरह से सीधा सीधा बड़ी सारी चीजों में इसका सीधा सीधा संबंध होने वाला है. एक और बात सामने आई है कि इन्वेस्टिगेशन एजेंसीज एक बात सामने लेकर आए हैं कि जितनी भी वायलेशन होंगी उनमें मोस्ट कॉमन इन्ग्रीडियंट जो होगा वो इस वायलेशन में वो बेनामी ट्रांजेक्शन का होगा. क्योंकि जब कहीं भी कोई भी वायलेशन होगा तो उसमें चांसेस इस बात के होंगे कि बेनामी लॉ का कि बेनामी एंगल जरूर इन्वॉल्व होगा. क्योंकि कोई भी वायलेशन जब करेगा तो एसेट्स दूसरे नाम से एक्वायर करेगा, प्रॉपर्टी को ट्रांजेक्शन दूसरे नाम से करेगा, प्रॉपर्टी दूसरे नाम से रिटेन करेगा, एक्वायर करेगा. So element of Benami transaction will most likely be involved. Vice versa may not be possible. कि बेनामी कर रहा है तो वो इलीगल काम भी किया होगा, ऐसा जरूरी नहीं है. बट इलीगल कर रहा है तो चांसेस हैं कि कुछ ना कुछ बेनामी भी किया होगा. तो बेनामी की कॉन्सेप्ट, चूंकि आज हम फंडामेंटल्स नहीं ले रहे हैं, तो इसलिए मैं एक क्विकली एक बता देता हूं कि बेनामी की कॉन्सेप्ट है क्या. व्हाट डू वी मीन बाय द टर्म बेनामी और किस चीज के ऊपर बेस्ड है ये कॉन्सेप्ट. देखिए बेनामी की कॉन्सेप्ट सीधी सीधी बात है कि ड्यूअलिटी के ऊपर बेस्ड है. कि जब कोई चीज दो डिस्टिंक्शन आ जाती है, जब यानी कि जब कोई रजिस्टर्ड ओनर और उसका जो रियल ओनर है, जो रियल बेनिफिट उठाता है, ये दो लोगों में एक दो फाड़ हो जाते हैं, जहां एक डिस्टिंक्शन आ जाती है, अलग हो जाते हैं, दो हिस्सों में बढ़ जाती है ये कॉन्सेप्ट, वहां बेनामी आ जाता है बीच में. जैसे हमारे शास्त्रों में भी कहा है कि जब ड्यूअलिटी आती है वही प्रॉब्लम आती है, जब तक नॉन ड्यूअलिटी है तब तक कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं. नॉन ड्यूअलिटी मतलब सब कुछ अलाइंड है, आपकी माइंड बॉडी सोल एंड द सुप्रीम एनर्जी, इफ ऑल ऑफ देम आर अलाइंड नो प्रॉब्लम. द मोमेंट ड्यूअलिटी कम्स दे गेट डिस्कनेक्टेड, ओनली देन द प्रॉब्लम कम्स. So similarly here also, the moment any duality comes, so the concept of ownership, if it is divided into two parts, when real and other is registered or the namesake, then the concept of Benami comes. And the other conditions are that suppose I will try to explain with the help of an example. There is one Mr. A who has paid amount to the seller B. Some property has been purchased by him. And amount has been paid by him, but the property has been registered in the name of Mr. C. So A is making the payment to B, and the transaction is being done in the name of C. So C becomes the registered owner because transaction has been done in his name. Transfer of title is his name from B to C. But the real ownership concept is exercised by A, and A has paid the consideration. So A is making the payment, the consideration. He has chosen the person C so that the property can be retained in the name of C. So that is how the concept of Benami comes into play. So now two persons have come into existence instead of one. That is A and C. Now A should have been the only person who should have been in the picture. He should have been the total owner, whether registered or beneficial in whatever manner. But A created a situation whereby he remained the beneficial owner, meaning thereby no ownership in documents. But he made someone else, that is Benamidar, that is Mr. C, as the registered owner. So under the provisions of PBPT, such kind of transaction is called as Benami transaction. The property so held by Mr. C is called as Benami property. Mr. C will be called as Benamidar, and Mr. A will be called as beneficial owner because he will be retaining all the ownership and beneficial rights therein. So in fact, Act has divided into four parts. The definition of Benami has been divided into four parts. It's not that only what we have discussed is only one part. And the first part was where it was said that property transferred to or held by Benamidar, consideration paid by beneficial owner, and property held for the benefit of the beneficial owner. This is what we have already studied. Now the other is where property held in fictitious name. If property is held in fictitious name, say in dog's name, so in the name of any deity, goddess, god, if any such thing is held which is not treated as a natural person in the eyes of law, so if property is held in any such name, then that will be also treated as Benami property, straight and simple. Then where the owner, C part says, where the owner himself is not aware about the ownership, knowledge of ownership, and he denies the fact of ownership, then such kind of properties can also be treated as Benami properties. Then clause D says, if pair of consideration, meaning thereby in the last example which I took, In this example, a pair of consideration is A here. So if A is not traceable or is fictitious, then that kind of transaction can also be treated as Benami transaction. So four parts have been given: part A, part B, part C, and part D. So these have been so widely drafted that in any one of the transactions, at least a person's case would fall. All possible situations that may exist on earth, all those have been taken here. There are certain exceptions, and exceptions are that if the property is taken in the name of karta, or if the person acting in the fiduciary capacity, for example, executor, trustee, partner, director, if property has been taken in their name on behalf of, say, company or firm, then it will also not be Benami. Then in the name of spouse or in the name of child, own spouse, not anybody else's spouse, own spouse and own child, then also it will not be Benami. Then brother lineal, brother sister lineal descendant or descendant. In that case, joint ownership is mandatory. So meaning thereby, if you have bought the property in the name of your mother or in the name of your father, then if you are not joint owner, then that property will also be treated as Benami property. If you yourself claim as the owner. Then power of attorney cases. In power of attorney cases, also they say it will be Benami, unless of course two conditions are fulfilled, and two conditions are that applicable stamp duty has been paid and that the power of attorney is registered. So the act of giving power of attorney is registered, the contract of giving power of attorney is registered, and applicable stamp duty has been paid. If these two conditions are fulfilled, only then power of attorney cases will be saved. Otherwise, the casual power of attorney cases, illegal power of attorney cases will also be trapped under the concept of Benami law, and such kind of properties will be subject to attachment and later on confiscation under the PPPT Act by the central government. So friends, this is the broad concept about what are Benami transactions and what are the savings. So meaning thereby, if anything falls in A, B, C and D and it does not fall in the exception, it will be Benami. It falls under A or B or C or D and does not fall under these exceptions, it is straight away Benami. Now, what are the authorities dealing with? So the job of enforcement under Benami law has been provided to the initiating officer, has been provided to the enforcement, to the income tax department. So one unit has been carved out after the investigation wing of income tax department called as Benami Prohibition Unit, BPU. And BPU comprises of initiating officer approving and approving authority, that is the assistant commissioner of the DCIT and approving authority who may be joint commissioner or additional commissioner. So these two authorities are there who are doing job of enforcement. And virtually every state capital has one BPU as on date. So initiating officer does the work of enforcement execution as the assessing officer does. But what it does is it does the work of investigation wing also, because it has been given powers under section 19 to make inquiries. So before the notice is issued under section 24.1, the initiating officer makes the proceedings begin by issuing notices under section 24, under section 19, by which he can conduct any inquiries, impound any documents, and then he can make provisional attachment of the property in other sections, which I will discuss. So initiating officer's role is to issue the notices and to make provisional attachment of the order. And for doing this, what he has to do is mandatorily get approval for various actions. That is when he passes provisional attachment order or continuing attachment order under section 24.4, then he has to seek approval from the approving authority, who is his immediate superior, joint commissioner. Then after this matter is done, orders are framed by the initiating officer, then the matter does not remain with the income tax department and it reaches to the adjudicating authority. Yes, what is this, friends? This adjudicating authority is the same authority which is discharging the function under PMLA also. So under PMLA law, adjudicating authority has been functioning, and now the additional job, additional burden of deciding the Benami cases have also been given to the adjudicating authority. It is set up in Delhi, located in Delhi, and at present it has three members. One of them is chairman, who is from IAS background. Other gentleman is lawyer, and other gentleman is chief commissioner, former chief commissioner of income tax department. And then we have appellate tribunal. It is the appellate tribunal. It is not the income tax appellate tribunal. It is the appellate tribunal. So once the orders are decided by adjudicating authority, the aggrieved party may approach to the appellate tribunal. Now appellate tribunal here means the tribunal which was set up for SAFEMA and COFEPOSA. Later on also it was given the function of being a tribunal under section 25 of PMLA, that is ED. And then it is also discharging the function under NDPS, that is narcotic drugs and substances, psychotropic substances. So, I mean, all this, and then FEMA also, it is also deciding the appeals of FEMA. So all these functions, this tribunal is deciding, and this Benami law is just one of them and the latest addition. And then we have administrator. Administrator is of the rank of income tax officer, and his job is to receive and manage the property and to dispose the property as per the guidelines issued by the central government. Then you may be sometimes thinking that how the officer will come to know about the Benami transaction. It is because of this that the act has been drafted in a manner which is pull mode as well as push mode. Now push mode means that whatever information other agencies will get, they are duty bound to inform to the initiating officer. Any of the officers whom I mentioned here, if any information comes to them, they are duty bound to inform the jurisdictional IO. Similarly, vice versa is also true. The jurisdictional initiating officer, that is BPU officer, can make inquiry and call for the information from any of these authorities who have been mentioned here. And once he issues the notice and asks for an information, these authorities are duty bound to provide the information. Otherwise, they will also be liable to some fine and prosecution. Then, friends, one expression has been used. If you remember, I have said that there is one exclusion. The exclusion of karta, person acting in fiduciary capacity, spouse, child, brother, sister. The one condition is attached to it, which I forgot to mention. And the condition is that these persons should acquire a property through known sources, meaning thereby the person acquiring the property, who is the actual owner, he will be making the consideration. So payment of consideration should be known through known sources, from known sources. So legislature has not used the word taxpayer sources or declared sources or disclosed sources. They have used a peculiar word, which is called known sources. So known means what? Known means whether something which is disclosed. No, otherwise they have used the word disclosed. So known means something which can be described. So for example, I would say that I have paid this amount from my bank account and the source is from salary income. So this is known sources. And similarly, we can take many more examples. So it is a concept is dicey and it has not been defined anywhere in the Act. Now quickly, I will take up the some definitions and some exceptions there too. So one of the exceptions in this definition of section 29A is that person standing in fiduciary capacity for the benefit of another person towards whom he stands in such capacity and includes a trustee, executor, partner, director of the company, depository, or a participant as an agent of the depository, and another person has to be notified by the central government. So the first thing is that this is an inclusive definition. So meaning thereby, whatever is included, mentioned here, that is included in the fiduciary capacity. But it does not exclude any other possibility. Ye sari cheeze to aayengi. Ye to include hongi specifically. But iske alawa kuch aur bhi agar koi capacity aisi hogi jo law mein fiduciary capacity recognized ho, wo bhi isme cover hogi. Jaise ki relationship of trustee, wo to khair naam aa raha hai. Then other could be like holding and nominee company relationship. So if the holding company holds 100% shareholding of the subsidiary company, but to make the number two, one share is held by some other company also, and some other person also, whom we call as nominee of the holding company. So that other person holds the share on behalf of the former, and consideration is paid by the former only. So he is holding in the same in fiduciary capacity only. Now, fiduciary capacity need not be explicit only. It can be implicit as well. And it was so held by so Honorable Supreme Court in Marcel Martin versus M. Printer, 21 Taxman.com/7. It's worth reading judgment. And then fiduciary capacity, actually the significance of fiduciary capacity also can be taken from Section 88 of Indian Trust Act. In fact, just to give a historical background, Indian Trust Act was enacted in 1882. And 3-4 sections were created therein, that is Section 81, 82 and 94 of Indian Trust Act, wherein it was clearly opined, wherein it was clearly provided that a person can take property in the name of other person in Benami manner, meaning thereby whenever such kind of transaction is done, the law will protect the rights of the real owner. So in a way, 1882 Act had allowed Benami transactions, and not only 1882 Act, but 1961 Act of Income Tax Act, that is Income Tax Act 1961, also allowed Benami transactions, especially when we read Section 281A of Income Tax Act, which provides the privilege to buy the property in Benami name, provided the information is given to the commissioner or jurisdictional chief commissioner. and if any such information is given, thereafter the response, the burden of the person was over. He could not have been roped into any kind of Benami law. The only difficulty was that he could not have recovered the property by way of legal suit. Otherwise, it was all allowed. But when the act was brought out in 1988 with respect to Benami transactions, so this is not the first time in 2016 when act has come. The only difference is when the 1988 act came, it contained only 9 sections. And even 9 sections were not put to force because the requisite notification to set up the acquisition authorities and enforcement agencies was never brought to light. So that is why the act remained in inactive mode. So, but one thing is very important, that 1988 act at least repealed all these sections which I have read, that is section 81, 82 and 94 of Indian Trust Act 1882 and section 281A of Indian Income Tax Act. So meaning thereby the message was writ large from the government that we do not want any Benami transactions to happen. So endorsement from the government was over. But pleasantly, section 88 of the Indian Trust Act, that is which talks about fiduciary capacity, that has been retained. So that means the government is of the view that in the fiduciary capacity sits still property can be bought in other names. Now this is about interplay, which I have already dealt with, but this slide has again been opened so that you can also have a proper grasp. So you can see that Benami law is in the pivot, in the center, and there are other laws which are revolving around it. So Benami law is daily surrounded. It does not have mostly its own independence. So some other violation will take place from there. Benami transactions might arise. So there is going to be strong interplay. So we should understand, while understanding the Benami law, the basic provisions of other laws also. Interplay with Income Tax Act. So interplay with income tax is such that suppose an addition has been made under section 68 on account of bogus share capital, and if some admissions are made during the course of assessment or interrogation that yes, friends, can you hear me? I am not having any remarks or anything. Slides are absolutely visible.
Yes sir, okay.
And my sound quality is all right? Any change required?
No sir, bilkul okay, perfect okay.
So I was saying that there can be situations where a person can end up in making payment of income tax as well as it can be also roped in under Benami law. How? Suppose a search takes place and person makes surrender of say bogus share capital, and if he makes surrender, then he has to pay tax thereon. But since he has made already surrender, so Benami officer can also record his statement, BPO officer can also record his statement on the ground that since you have already made a surrender, that means the share capital is bogus. That means you had given cash to the company who has provided the share capital, and that company has in lieu provided the check. So that means the share certificates which have been issued to that company is not the real owner. So real owner is the director of the investee company. So that means that company is holding it in Benami capacity. So that kind of situation may also arise. So before making any surrender, etc., kindly also calculate some things beyond the payment of tax. That is the implication under Benami law and implication under money laundering law also. So there are many situations where there is going to be strong interplay between the two, and there is going to be mutually accumulative action. And also there are few situations can be such when there may not be any cumulative exercise, but mutually exclusive exercise also. So it will depend upon fact to fact case also, case to case also, the facts may differ. So I had mentioned in the interplay slide that whether a transaction subjected to GAR be also exposed to Benami law, because the GAR is into force now. So if GAR is invoked, so how Benami law can also come into picture, particularly in international transactions. So here in this slide, I have depicted that suppose there is a company which is based in USA, and to make investment in Indian company to the share capital Indian company, it does not come straight away by the straight route from USA to India. Rather, it comes through Mauritius route. and it sets up another company at Mauritius and through then Mauritius and sends funds to Mauritian company, and Mauritian company in turn sends funds to India, and that is how Mauritian company becomes shareholder in Indian company. So if GAR is invoked on the ground that treaty benefit between India and Mauritius will not be given because the real owner is US company and Mauritian company is just a namesake owner. So under these circumstances, if any such order is passed, then the Benami law officer, that is BPU, can also come into picture, holding that the asset in India, that is the underlying shares invested in India, that is Benami property, which is attached, being Benami property, and that Mauritian company is treated as Benami dar, and US company is treated as beneficial owner. So that is how it has got reach more than what we had thought. Significant beneficial ownership concept, you are all aware of how in ROC it works, and there may be certain clauses whereby if the case is falling in that clause, it may straight away be hit under Benami law also. Then very important practical aspect which arise when we are required to make representation of Benami proceedings is that whose burden is what, because the success of any good representation lies in the fact that primarily or firstly the whose burden is what, that should be understood. So here under Benami law, it may be enforced by the Income Tax Department, but there is nothing common except that that the implementation agency is common, enforcement agency is common. But friends, otherwise, believe me, this law has got, Benami law has got nothing to do with income tax law. Both are absolutely different. So then the issue arose, then while we make representation, we follow a particular methodology. But the same methodology when we represent before the IU under Benami law can be followed? The answer to this is absolutely no, because every act has different sphere, different requirements, etc., etc. So therefore, we have to understand the concept which is applicable here under income tax law. And the first thing which we must understand is the concept of burden of proof. So if you want to learn the art and skill of representation, the first thing which you must learn is the concept of burden of proof. So whole art and skill of representation lies in understanding the concept of burden. So whose burden is what, when it can be said to have been discharged, when not, to what extent yes, to what extent not. So this is the most important question which arise. So this question arose before us also when I was arguing before the appellate tribunal. And then I took help of these two judgments, P. Lilavati and Mangathai, Amal Mangathai from Supreme Court, latest judgment, wherein it has been held that the burden to prove a property or a transaction as Benami is upon the initiating officer. Then taking help of these two judgments, we made arguments in Pamela Bhardwaj case, which is at the mentioned at the bottom of the slide. We also made arguments in Pamela Bhardwaj case. And in that case, it has been finally held, yes, burden of proof is probably, this is a published order now, and probably it is from Karnal or something, this matter. And though notice was issued from Delhi. So ultimately, two judgments have been followed by the BPU, and it has been held, yes, the order that the burden of proof is upon the initiating officer. Initiating officer has to prove firstly that this is Benami transaction or this is Benami property. Only then the burden of the other person will start. So while making representation, this should be kept in mind that reverse should not be done. Otherwise, unnecessary damage may be caused to the client. Then what are the consequences of Benami transaction? Suppose a transaction is found to be Benami, what are the consequences? So broadly, these are the three consequences which I have listed out before you in the slide. And the first consequence is that there is going to be attachment, oblique confiscation of Benami property or proceeds thereof. So firstly, what happens there is attachment takes place first of all. So that is what makes this law very stinging. Very, very stinging and highly irritating also sometimes. Because under income tax law, first income tax inquiry letter will come, an assessment notice will come, the assessment order will come, then maybe appeal order will come, then second appeal, then third appeal, then high court, then Supreme Court, etc., etc. And then immovable property attachment, etc. may arise sometimes late in the life of the assessee or sometimes even after that. But here in Benami proceedings, it's not like that. The proceedings begin with the attachment, provisional attachment. So initiating officer, if he is of the opinion that so and so property is Benami, then he can record the reasons and issue notice to the respective parties, that is Benamidar and beneficial owner. And simultaneously, it can also issue provisional attachment order under Section 24(3) of the PPPT Act 1988, read with amended law in 2016. So, immediately after the issuance of notice under Section 24(1), the IO initiating officer, that is an enforcement agency of the BPU, can also make provisional attachment and pass provisional attachment order, PAO, and attach the provisional attach the property. So, while making attachment under Section 24(3), there are certain conditions stipulated. For example, the first condition is that the property is likely to be alienated. But nobody is bothered about this condition, but attachment is done, lock, stock, and barrel. Okay. And then the second jo instance hai, jo consequence hai, and that is prosecution and rigorous imprisonment of person who are found guilty of offense of Benami transactions and fine up to 25% of fair market value of property payable by each person held guilty of offense of Benami transaction. So there is a prosecution, then imprisonment, and then fine also 25% market value of property. And this fine will be applicable upon whom? It is applicable A to Benamidar, B to beneficial owner, and C to any other person who has advised them to do Benami transaction, who is said to be abettor, who is said to be person guilty of offense of Benami transaction because of whose advice the Benami transaction has been done. And then there is another prosecution for false information and fine. Rigorous imprisonment for 6 months to 5 years for any person knowingly giving false information, public documents, and fine up to 10% of fair market value of property. So very, very harsh consequences. Then let's come to provisional attachment. The provisional attachment by the initiating officer can be done for a maximum period of 90 days from the end of the month in which SCN is issued. Earlier it was from the date of, but now it is from the end of the month in which SCN is issued. Then after the 90 days period is over, then the IO is obliged to either release the property or to make the PAO allowing the continuation of the PAO by the initiating officer under Section 24(4) till the adjudication appeal is decided, adjudication by the adjudication authority under 26(3). So when he makes the provisional attachment order, then thereafter when he continues it after the end of the 90 days period, then he can continue it up to the adjudication is done by the adjudication authority under Section 26(3). So, provisional attachment, though, is couched in very, very safe words, but the way the powers are being used, so it has become quite dangerous. On any small thing or big thing, the PO is done immediately. Then requisite conditions for making provisional attachment. As I said, conditions are not being followed by the IOs, but what he should follow is, he should first of all should have issued notice under Section 24(1). If he will issue the notice 24(1), no, that kind of attachment is illegal. Similarly, second condition is possession of property with the person held Benami. Then he should also ensure that that property is in whose possession. And if it is in a possession of third party, then he cannot make attachment. Then it will be a claim of bona fide purchaser by the third party. But if this kind of innocence is not proved, then he should see that the property is held in possession as Benami. Because if he does not treat it as Benami, then again there will be a lot of problems. And then the next issue which arises here is that he should fear alienation of the property during the period specified in notice under Section 24(1). So meaning thereby, he should fear that in case this provisional attachment is not done, then this property may be transferred. So this kind of fear of alienation should not be arising only on the basis of his mindset or figment of imagination. Rather, he should get some material that yes, from so and so material, it can be said that this property is likely to be alienated. Then next is prior approval from the approving authority. As I said, he or she would be the approving authorities. Then effect of attachment. So far we understood how attachment is done, consequences of attachment, how they do it, then how they issue notice under Section 24(1). But now suppose Section 1 has been In fact, one thing more I wanted to say here. Now, last column, if you see prior approval of private authority, this I forgot to mention. Whenever any continuation, any order for the provisional attachment order is passed, or whenever any order continuing the provisional attachment order is passed, it is mandatory that the IO must obtain prior approval of the approving authority. Now, the same fundamentals which we apply in the judgment given on section 151 of Income Tax Act, similar judgments will be applicable here also, that if the authority which is granting the if the approving authority which is granting the sanction is not applied his mind, that such kind of approval, such kind of sanction or satisfaction is no approval or no satisfaction in the eyes of law. So he should apply his mind, and only then he could give some proper sanction or approval.
Ashwani sir, sorry to interrupt, sir, but a question hai sir, shayad wo relevant hai yahi par, to puchu sir. Isme likha hai sir, CA Venkata Subramanian ne, what will be the consequences if some company acquire property through investment from foreign entities whom the company is not able to identify?
Chat box mein hai question?
Ji sir, chat box mein hai sir.
Chat box main bhi khol leta hu. Chat mere paas aa kyun nahi raha? Yes, here it is.
The last question.
What will be the consequence if some company acquires properties through investments from foreign entities whom the company is not able to identify? In fact, brother, as far as 29A is concerned, there is no problem. You have to be careful with regard to clause number 2D. Clause D can be the only problem. Though the purpose of the clause D is where there is no person existing as on date with regard to the payment of consideration. So it is not to rope in those cases where section 68 or 69 can be applied. Rather, those cases which can escape from 68 or 69, only those cases can be roped in. But wherever we are not able to establish the existence even of the person providing the consideration, then we should be very careful. The department is in a full mood and full swing to invoke clause D also to treat that property Benami here. So kindly be careful in this matter particularly.
Okay, sir.
Acha, there is one gentleman. I just read, he's saying, can you converse in English? Is it so? I was under the impression that I am addressing only Panipat branch. So it will be very convenient for the Panipat branch brothers and sisters to, if I converse in Hindi also. So, Bhupendraji, will it be convenient for if I start speaking in English?
Sunil sir, starting mein aapka deliberation Hindi mein tha, lekin uske baad aapka completely English mein. Jo gaye the wo aa chuke hain sir baas.
Achha. No, it is not a matter of. It should be comfortable for all, because wherever I speak totally in English, then people would say, sir, we are from the Hindi belt. Yes, if you can speak Hindi.
Yes, sir. So majority, I don't know. Majority are Hindi belt, sir.
So what should I do? Tell me.
Sir, both languages should be used, sir.
Okay, my Keralite brothers and sisters. I will try to be as explicit as possible, but kindly understand, use mixed language. Ramnath Mohriji is saying use mixed language. All right. So effect of attachment. Even if I will speak English, I will try to be as simple as possible. Effect of attachment. Whether all rights. So now the question arises, suppose property is attached. The next important question that arises for our consideration is, what will be the effect? Whether all rights with respect to the enjoyment of the property come to an end, or only right to transfer the property becomes restricted. Very, very important, because the moment property is attached, things become haywire, lot of tensions come up. The depression comes up. What has happened? Property has gone. But friends, here I would like to say one thing, that here property is being simply attached, and attached that too provisionally. And even when the provisional attachment is continued or confirmed by the issuing authority, unless the confiscation is ordered by the government, the attachment mainly remains on the right of transfer of property, which will be evident from the provisions which I'll be reading before you. Now, first of all, attachment is defined under section 2.5, and section 2.5 says Attachment means the prohibition of transfer, conversion, disposition, or movement of property by an order issued under this act. So it is nowhere saying attachment means that there should not be any permission to use the property. Attachment means only prohibition on transfer of property. Then section 57, if you read, it declares certain transfers to be null and void. So what it is saying that suppose 24-1 notice has been issued, then any property referred to in the said notice transferred by any mode whatsoever, the transfer shall be null and void, shall be ignored. So what it is restricting is transfer. Then what are the implications of shares being attached under section 24? So whether there is going to be restriction on right of voting, or restriction on right of participating in shareholders meeting also, or restriction on right to receive dividend also, restriction to pledge shares also, or restriction to sell oblique transfer of shares also. What is your view on that? In fact, if you see, only one right is with regard to the right of usage. One right is right of transfer, other rights are right of usage. So there will be rather last two rights, that is right to pledge shares and restriction to sell transfer of shares. So only transfer of shares, pledging of shares, anything which is tinkering with the title of the property, ownership rights in the property, only that rights are being freezed, are being attached, not the right to use. So restriction on right of voting, no. Right to use only. Restriction on right to participate in shareholders meeting or right to receive dividend, no problem at all, because they are all merely right of usage. No title of the property is being touched. Then this by Honorable Supreme Court in the case of Balkishan Gupta versus Swadeshi Politics Limited, which says that attachment of shares do not deprive the shareholder of the right to vote at a meeting and other allied rights. Then attachment of land and building. Here again the same question arises: with right of usage of property, right to keep tenant, right to receive dividend, right of construction oblique development, right to mortgage, right of subdivision of plots, right of entering into development agreement, right to sell transfer. So out of them also, whatever rights are touching the aspect of ownership, only to that extent attachment will be there. Otherwise, as far as right of usage is concerned, for example, tenant, rent receiving, construction development, no problem, so long as full ownership rights are retained. Right to mortgage, yes, when we mortgage, then some ownership rights are compromised. So that may not be possible. Confiscation and vesting of Benami property. Now, how confiscation takes place? In fact, though, first of all, the procedure is something like that. The initiating officer begins the inquiries, then passes the order. Then the matter reaches to the adjudicating authority. We represent before the adjudicating authority. And then adjudicating authority either confirms or releases the property if it does not accept the IO. So suppose if it releases the property, the matter comes to an end. But if the adjudicating authority confirms the attachment, then whether confiscation takes place immediately? No. Then if the aggrieved person is given the right to file appeal before the appellate tribunal. It is not the income tax appellate tribunal. It is the appellate tribunal, which is tribunal of Safima, Kofi Posa, NDPS, PMLA, and Benami Law also now. So the matter reaches to the appellate tribunal. The appellate tribunal thereafter decides the appeal. And after the appeal is decided, only thereafter the confiscation proceedings can take place. So if tribunal has reversed the order of adjudicating authority, confiscation proceedings may not take place. Then the confiscation shall be done by the adjudicating authority after giving opportunity of hearing to the person concerned. So after the appeal order is passed by the tribunal, the adjudicating authority will make a fresh inning and will start fresh proceedings, giving the parties opportunity before declaring the confiscation. Then procedure for confiscation, of course, to be prescribed. Then after confiscation, all rights and title in the property to vest absolutely in the central government. This should be very clear. No compensation is payable in respect of compensation. So, aap jo kehte the baat sab theek hai, land to aapne le li, muawza kitna dilwaoge, bolo, no, nothing doing. If it was Benami, then no compensation payable in respect of confiscation. Then protection to bona fide purchaser. Then provisions of confiscation do not to apply to any property held or acquired by a person from Benamidar, provided the said property was acquired for adequate consideration and prior to issuance of notice under section 24-1. and the purchaser had no knowledge of the Benami transaction. So, दो ये बड़ा important slide है, आपके समक्ष ये सारी बातें आ सकती हैं. You may yourself land yourself in trouble, or your client may land himself or herself in trouble if the due care is not taken and property purchase happens to be Benami. So if it happens, so if 24-1 is issued subsequent to the purchase of property, then there is a benefit which can be claimed of bona fide purchaser. Otherwise, property will be purchased, and that protection can be claimed under Section 27 only, for which two conditions have been prescribed. That is, the property should be for adequate consideration, should be purchased by the person, and there should be no knowledge of the issuance of a notice under Section 24-1. And it should be purchased prior to issuance of notice under Section 24-1. If the notice under Section 24-1 was already issued and a person purchases the property, then that property is just a rough piece of paper for him, because as I said, Section 57 clearly says then the such kind of transfer shall be null and void, and law is very clear on that. Then another question which arises here is whether Section 91, 92, 101, 102 and 106 of Indian Evidence Act shall also be applicable here, meaning thereby which says that the documentary evidences shall prevail over the oral evidences. So really somebody has said yes, this is Benami property, but written evidences are not there, and rather documentary evidences are saying no, this so and so person is the owner. So whether the statement given under Section 91, 92 can be overridden by the documentary evidences, so the answer is no, because so long as because both are offsprings of Constitution of that is Indian Evidence Act and Benami law. So long as anything contrary is mentioned under Benami law, and in Indian Evidence Act will definitely have all the provisions shall be applicable as they are. So therefore, whenever such situation arises, kindly make use of Section 91, 92, 101, 102 and 106, which talks about various documentary evidences, etc. Then power of arrest. Whether initiating of power of arrest, whether it has power of service, search and seizure. Answer to both is no. Thankfully, no. Now, as far as power of arrest is concerned, it is given only to the enforcement directorate or CBI. It is not even with the income tax department. So, income tax department can make search, but not power of arrest. And power of search and surveillance seizure is also not there. That is also only with income tax department. But why this law has become suddenly so obnoxious is because the usage of coordinated agencies. So, income tax department has been given the task of implementation. So therefore, what is happening is that search and seizure, etc. is conducted by the income tax officer and by the income tax department, and most of the officers are common IRS background officers. So they know what documents is for what purpose. So from there, sufficient information is generated and that information is being used by BPU. So writ jurisdiction, I am skipping it for the time being. Then certain one case study, which is a little complex. I think instead of case study, if I can take up, this is famous DHFL case. You must have heard about it. It was published in newspaper also. It was first appeal which we won from the tribunal. The first appeal which I filed from the our office was actually the first appeal in the country, and that was from Karnal, as I mentioned in the name of Pamela Bhardwaj, Mrs. Pamela Bhardwaj and Ramneet Singh Kochar versus AIO, wherein the fundamental concept of burden of proof has been very, very much clarified. And this was the first order which was given by the tribunal, which was published in Economic Times also. And here the situation is like this, that DHFL was the lender. It gave loan amount to Manpreet, one other company, one Manpreet Estate LLP. And Manpreet Estate was developer also. And it purchased certain properties from five individuals. That individual happened to be, in fact, former employees of RK Developers, another company. And RK Developers and DHFL both were related parties. So it was alleged that, in fact, indirectly the consideration has been provided by DHFL. And in fact, indirectly consideration has been paid by DHFL. And therefore, this property is Benami property of DHFL, whose Benamidar is Manpreet and beneficial owner is DHFL. But tribunal did not agree with this contention because we could demonstrate that this property has been purchased in independent capacity and DHFL is only a lender. And merely because lending has been done, that is not equivalent to providing the consideration. So good judgment, worth reading. You can read it on the site also. Then this is a non-resident case. Very important thing. In fact, many of your friends or relatives may unknowingly get stuck up in this kind of scenario. Therefore, I am putting it before you. Now, in this case, what happened, there is one NRI gentleman and he wanted to buy land in India and he wanted to buy agricultural land. We could not have bought. So he took help of his Indian friend and Indian friend invested and he and the NRI friend sent money from abroad and Indian friend purchased the land in his name. But subsequently, such took place upon the builder from whom land was taken, and also it happened upon the gentleman, that is the Indian friend, and it was told by the search officials that some own money has been paid in acquisition of this transaction and acquisition of this plot of land. So he got scared. He said then, no sir, mera to kuch nahi hai, I don't own anything here. This transaction I have done just to help my NRI friend. This entire land belongs to him. I'm just the namesake person who has become the registered owner, etc., etc., he said. So the immediate action was thereafter that whatever will happen in the income tax department is a matter of subsequent thing. But BPU swung into action and that land was treated as Benami property attached and that Indian friend as Benamidar and that foreign friend as beneficial owner. So foreign friend means NRI friend as beneficial owner. So the moment he steps back into the country, then his prosecution is also due. But his prosecution and attachment of property has already been done. Then concept of money laundering. So I will take 5 minutes, then we can have question answer session also. So friends, in fact, what is concept of money laundering? Would anybody would like to make a guess, can raise hand and try to explain, then I will give you my thoughts on what is money laundering. Anybody would like to make a guess? Bhupendra ji, you can, anybody who raises hand or wants to open it, you can please give him a chance, because let us make it a participative session.
Yes.
What is the concept of money laundering? So somebody says, sir, money laundering means when we convert from black to white money. But if that is money laundering, that is also covered in tax evasion. So money laundering does not only create black to white, it also converts black and red together to white. So there should be red and black. Red means money from crime. So if whenever the money is which is received from commission of a crime, if it is converted, then that kind of money so converted will be categorized into money laundering. So somebody says, Sachin says rotation of money. No. There has to be clarity about the understanding of the concept. So tax evasion is not money laundering. Tax evasion is tax evasion, which is punishable under the provisions of Indian Income Tax Act 1961, or if it is a matter of indirect taxes, that under the relevant laws of GST, etc., or excise laws or customs laws, whatever they are. As far as direct tax laws, so it is punishable under Income Tax Act 1961, and according to that only the liability will be determined. But as far as money laundering is concerned, there has to be, let me understand first of all there has to be illegal dirty money. So meaning thereby, there has to be crime. First of all, a person does some crime, scheduled offense, and there is a long list of scheduled offense, you see, wherein the provisions of Black Money Act has also been mentioned in the list, recently added. Then we have Prevention of Corruption Act, any violation there. Then we have also Wildlife Protection, Water Pollution Act, etc., etc. So the list is very, very wide. Then many provisions of IPC like forgery, fraud, etc., etc. So cheating, all those things are mentioned over there. So many provisions of IPC and a few provisions of Black Money Act, so they are there, and then PC Act, etc., are there. So a person has earned some money from commission of any of the offenses, and that money so earned is portrayed to be good money, though there is some amendment in the last condition, but still I am of the opinion that this condition also should be there. So it can be divided into these three stages. So stage one, commission of the scheduled offense, then stage two, proceeds of generation of proceeds of crime, and stage three, commission of money laundering by placement layering integration, meaning thereby when the color of the money is changed, meaning thereby when the bad money is portrayed as good money. So that is how it is done, placement, layering and integration. So friends, what I was saying, in fact, I will try to explain with the help of an example. Suppose a person has done some smuggling, and from smuggling, say he has earned rupees 10 crores, and he discloses in his income tax return that I have income from smuggling rupees 10 crores. Now let us try to evaluate what are the possible violations. So one by one, let us take violation under FEMA. It could be there. Customs, yes, it could be there. Income tax act, no, because he has paid, he has disclosed full money. Then whether any Benami, no, nothing Benami has been done. Then under PMLA, because he is not showing that good money as bad money as good money, he is showing it as income from smuggling. So according to my understanding, he has not done offense under PMLA also. But let me little bit change the facts. Suppose in the second situation, what he does, the amount of 10 crores which he received from smuggling, what he does, out of this rupees 2 crore, he shows in income tax return as an income from consultancy, and the remaining amount he suppresses in cash, and out of the remaining 8 crore rupees, 3 crore he would send abroad, he sent abroad for being stashed into the bank account, and then remaining 5 crores he gave to one company for receiving share capital, and that company gives back the share capital in his company where he is partner and director. So B becomes the shareholder there, maybe namesake or whatever. So now let us evaluate what are the possible violations. First of all, FEMA, yes, it is there. Customs, yes, it is there. Black Money Act violation has taken place, because he has sent money abroad to be stashed in bank account, undisclosed bank account. So he has done violation, and therefore his taxes will be chargeable under Section 3 of Black Money Act, read with Section 4 and 5, and also read with Section 2 bracket 11 and 2 bracket 12, which defines the term undisclosed foreign assets and undisclosed foreign income, etc. And his assessment can be done under Section 10 of newly introduced Black Money Act. Number second, he has done offense under income tax. Yes, he has suppressed 8 crore rupees. So he is liable for prosecution and taxes both. Then whether under FEMA, yes, I have already told under FEMA he will be liable. Then he will be also liable under Benami law, because the shares held by B Limited will be in the Benami capacity. Then under PMLA also, under PMLA law also, he has done offense, because he is shown the bad money as good money to the extent of rupees full 10 crores. So money laundering offense has also been done. So that is how I can say, even if the facts are same, but there are little bit elements of giving rise to different offenses. So friends, earlier I used to say quite often nowadays that the time has come when we as a professionals, as citizens of this country also, align and realign ourselves because of the change in the scenario now with respect to the laws dealing with economic offenses especially. Now the cost of non-compliance has become this much higher. Cost, say this is cost of compliance, and cost of non-compliance has become this much higher. So since cost of non-compliance is too much high, it is better to make compliance and incur the lower cost. Because earlier, the cost of compliance used to be higher. Cost of non-compliance negligible. Now it is not like that. Now it is like that. So, and in most of the laws, now chartered accountants are being roped in as a better, etc., etc. So it is better to do transactions at arm's length principle with the client. And one thing last bit I would say, that with the help of this Benami law particularly, let us learn that how to live life. So I sometimes say that what Benami law is suggesting us is that whatever I think from inside, I should portray from outside the same thing. Whatever I want to look from inside, I should need to look from outside the same way. And whatever is mine, I should think that only mine. I should neither tell anything else to be mine, nor think anything else to be mine. In nutshell, I should get rid of Benami life and I should live real life. Friends, thank you very much for the keen participation. And we can have questions and answers if there are any. Thank you, Bhupinder ji, and thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Ashwani sir. और एक बट सर का क्वेश्चन है सर, एक चैट बॉक्स में आया है। बट सर आप अनम्यूट भी कर लीजिए सर, अगर आप पूछना चाहते हैं। बट सर जी सर, जी सर,
हेलो सर।
जी सर, बट सर क्वेश्चन इज, व्हेन ए प्रॉपर्टी इज ट्रीटेड एज बिनामी, इन एडिशन टू कॉन्फिस्केशन ऑफ द प्रॉपर्टी, एक्शंस अंडर इनकम टैक्स आल्सो पॉसिबल? यस सर, वेरी राइट क्वेश्चन, वेरी गुड क्वेश्चन। एज आई टोल्ड that it will depend upon the facts of the case, and cumulative actions are possible. Section 60 and 67 of PPPT Act suggest that the law contained in this section is in addition to another law and not in subrogation of any other law. So if the income tax violation is done and also simultaneously Benami law violation is done, then actions under both the laws are possible. Thank you, sir. And Ramnath Muraji is asking, what to do if there is notice under Benami and how to save the client? sir, our job is to legally represent, legally protect our client. So if any notice comes up, then the right course of action will be to properly represent the proceedings before the initiating officer, keeping in view the concept of burden of law, keeping in view the various other things, so that proper representation can be done. If proper representation is not done, then of course the Benami law officer will immediately treat it as Benami, and then the hell will break its noose, and everything thereafter will be really unbearable. Yes, sir.
Sir, एक छोटी सी चीज मैं भी पूछना चाह रहा था कि जैसे मेरे क्लाइंट है सर, उनका एक सिविल रिकॉर्ड खराब है, तो उनको लोन नहीं मिल पा रहा है बैंक से, तो उन्होंने क्या किया कि अपने साले की प्रॉपर्टी पर, अपने साले को बोला कि तू लोन ले ले मेरी प्रॉपर्टी परचेज करने के लिए, तो उसने अपनी प्रॉपर्टी परचेज करवाने के लिए उसको लोन दिलवा दिया और उसको पैसे मिल गए सर, प्रॉपर्टी सिर्फ नेम ट्रांसफर हुआ है, जबकि जो पैसा है वो दोनों ने यूज किया है कुछ कुछ, तो ये ट्रांजेक्शन सर कहीं कवर होगी इस चीज में?
अब एक एक करके लेते हैं दोनों बातों को। सबसे ज्यादा जो प्रॉपर्टी जो साले के नाम से ली गई है, राइट
जी,
उसका रियल ओनर तो जीजा है, तो अगर ये बात कहीं रिकॉर्ड पे आ जाती है कि रियल ओनर जीजा है और वही ही हैज पेड द कंसीडरेशन एंड ही इज एंजॉयिंग द रियल ओनरशिप राइट्स, तो ये बेनामी प्रॉपर्टी डिक्लेयर हो जाएगी। अब इसमें से और कौन सा क्वेश्चन बचा? ऐसे ही जैसे मान लो बैंक लोन आता है, उसके नाम से आया, साले के नाम से, उसका रियल जो उसका हक है उस सारे पैसे के ऊपर अगर जीजा का है और साले साहब तो खाली नाम के लिए हैं, तो ये एक्सेप्शन क्लॉज में नहीं आता जो एक्सेप्शंस आई हैं, क्योंकि एक्सेप्शन क्लॉज में नहीं आता, उसमें सिर्फ स्पाउस और चाइल्ड है, बाकी सबके साथ तो जॉइंट ओनरशिप चाहिए, और साला तो उसमें एक्सेप्शन क्लॉज में ही नहीं है, तो इसलिए सालों का तो खास ध्यान रखा गया है इस बेनामी लॉ में, उनको तो तुरंत बेनामीदार की कैटेगरी में डाल दिया जाएगा।
तो सर इसका मतलब ये हुआ कि सर अगर हमारी फैमिली मेंबर से हमें प्रॉपर्टी, जैसे अगर मदर के नाम से प्रॉपर्टी मुझे परचेज करनी है, तो हमें जॉइंट नेम से रजिस्ट्री करवानी होगी सर उसकी, मदर के याद।
हाँ, अगर आप अपने आप को ओनर दिखाना चाहते हो तो आपको जॉइंट नेम से रजिस्ट्री करानी होगी, और अगर आप मदर को गिफ्ट देना चाहते हैं तो उस पर कोई पाबंदी नहीं है। तो ये बेनामी लोग कहता है कि लिव रियल लाइफ, रियल लाइफ से मतलब यही होता है कि पूर्ण समर्पण भाव अगर आप मदर को दिखाना चाह रहे हो तो पूर्ण दिखाइए, तो उन्हें गिफ्ट ही दीजिए, ऐसा नहीं कि देने को तो दिखाने को तो आप गिफ्ट दे रहे हो फिर अपने आप को ओनर दिखाते हो, तो वो बेनामी हो जाएगा ट्रांजेक्शन। जी
सर, आई थिंक बड़ा सर न्यू सा कांसेप्ट था हम सबके लिए सर के, और
काफी सारी चीजें, अगर अब आपको लगेगा कि एक फंडामेंटल कॉन्सेप्ट भी होनी चाहिए, क्योंकि मुझे लगता है हमारे बहुत सारे ब्रदर्स सिस्टर्स के लिए शायद नया हो, तो उनको लग रहा हो कि हम एडवांस टॉपिक की तो बातें होगी लेकिन बेनामी इन डिटेल कॉन्सेप्ट फंडामेंटली है क्या, वो नहीं बताया, तो उसको हम फिर कभी नेक्स्ट सेशन में लेंगे। अभी आप ये तथास्तु वाली सीरीज से फ्री हो लीजिए, तो जब कभी पानीपत ब्रांच इन्वाइट करेगी तो हम इकट्ठे जुड़े होंगे फिर।
नहीं सर, श्योर, बिल्कुल आपको इन्वाइट करेंगे सर, और आपने काफी सरल लैंग्वेज में हम सभी को सब बताया, और हल्का सा हमारे को सबको एक मन में एक प्लानिंग की जरूरत है कि हमें किस तरीके से अपनी जो थिंग्स है वो अलाइंड करनी है, जो जो हमने अभी तक की हुई है और जो जो सर अब तक कर चुके हैं वो तो नहीं हो पाएंगे, तो आगे के लिए तो चलो कर पाएंगे कुछ भी, वो तो नहीं हो पाएंगे।
अब मैं उस क्वेश्चन का आंसर देता हूँ, उससे पहले मैं बताना चाहूंगा, मेरे ख्याल से रेजा साहब भी जुड़ गए, रेजा साहब पहले शायद पानीपत में ही थे इनकम टैक्स डिपार्टमेंट में, आपको ध्यान हो तो, मेरे अभी फादर लॉ साहब है, हाँ, बिक रेजा जी का नाम मैं देख रहा हूँ।
आप एक बार अनम्यूट कर लीजिए सर,
अनम्यूट कर लो एक बार डैडी, और आ जाइए, हेलो कर लो सबसे, और वीडियो भी ऑन कर लीजिए।
रेजा सर, एक कमेंट है, तब तक मैं बता दूं सर, सेशन जुलाई की स्पार्क विल स्टडी डेफिनेटली अबाउट दिस।
ओके, चलो थैंक यू शिल्पा जी, अगर आपको सेशन अच्छा लगा तो बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद,
और सर आपको डिस्कस कर रहे
थे, कुछ बच गया है जानने को, तो हम दोबारा मिलेंगे ऑफ कोर्स, कि आज दो दो टॉपिक रख रहे थे, वो दो दो टॉपिक एक साथ हो नहीं सकते, हमें अगली बार बेनामी लॉ अलग से रखना पड़ेगा और मनी लॉन्ड्रिंग लॉ अलग से रखना पड़ेगा, ब्लैक मनी एक्ट अलग से, सब अलग अलग सब्जेक्ट डिस्कस करने के हैं।
रजा सर आप सुन पा रहे हैं सर, आप अनम्यूट हैं इनको से, आगे सर। रजा सर नमस्कार।
नमस्ते, नमस्ते जी। अच्छा, तो आज आई थिंक बहुत सारे लोग तो आपके जानकार जुड़े होंगे आज पानीपत से।
जी सर, सर मैसेज जाते हैं ना, तो जो भी इंटरेस्टेड है रेलेवेंट टॉपिक जिनको लगते हैं वो जुड़ ही जाते हैं सर, तो जैसे कल इंटरनेट, असल में सुनी सर हमारा क्या था, जैसे तथास्तु सिद्ध चल रही है, ये 10 डिफरेंट टॉपिक्स पे है, पहला टॉपिक था सर साइबर सिक्योरिटी पे, और क्योंकि हम सभी प्रोफेशनल जो है कंप्यूटर पे डिपेंडेंट है, तो हमारे को सिक्योर कैसे करना अपना डाटा क्लाइंट का डाटा, और सेकंड हमारा टॉपिक था सर इंटरनेशनल टैक्सेशन पे इशू इन फाइलिंग फॉर्म 15 CACB, और थर्ड सर आज ये है, और आज का जो शो है ये तो काफी आई ओपनर शो है, और काफी अभी सर कमेंट भी आ रहे हैं कि ब्यूटीफुल प्रेजेंटेशन सर, एंड भट्ट सर का, मौर्य सर का भी आ रहा है सर वंडरफुल प्रेजेंटेशन, काइंडली अरेंज वेबिनार ऑन फंडामेंटल ऑफ बेनामी लॉ। तो सर फंडामेंटल की डिमांड आ चुकी है सर, तो हम आज अभी इसी प्लेटफॉर्म से सर आपको एक बार फिर रिक्वेस्ट कर रहे हैं कि सर हमें प्लान करने वाले हैं जल्दी से, तो आपको सर जरूर इन्वाइट करेंगे सर।
अच्छा मैं एक रिक्वेस्ट करूंगा कि अगर आप काफी जुड़ जाएं, कुछ काफी ब्रांचेस जुड़ जाएं, एनआईआरसी से जुड़ जाएं तो और अच्छा हो जाएगा, तो हम डिटेल में एक इसके ऊपर फुल फ्लेश सेशन रख लेंगे बेनामी के ऊपर। आईसीआईसी से अप्रूवल लेकर जैसा भी ठीक समझे आप।
जी सर, जी सर, हम कोशिश ये करेंगे सर कि एनआईआरसी लेवल से साथ जुड़ के और दो तीन ब्रांच इकट्ठा होके और तब वेबिनार करवाएं ताकि सभी का बेनिफिट हो सके।
जी 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 जी, थैंक यू।
आई थिंक सर क्वेश्चन तो अभी कोई बचा नहीं, मैं ब्रांच के चेयरमैन सब इनवाइट करूंगा एक बार सर, जस्ट एंड सर। सुरेश सर आप अनम्यूट कर लीजिए सर। सुरेश सर सर वो टेक्निकल कुछ इशू है उसी करेंगे, अगर किसी मेंबर का सर कोई क्वेश्चन है तो आप अभी भी पूछ सकते हैं, ही स्टिल विद अस, अश्विनी सर हमारे साथ अभी हैं, और अदरवाइज आपका सर का नंबर जो है पीपीटी में सर, पीपीटी आप शेयर कर देना सर, मैं सभी को पार्टिसिपेंट को यहाँ से शेयर करना।
जी जी जी
सर, तो अगेन सर बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद सर आपका, और सच ए नाइस एंड वंडरफुल और एनर्जेटिक, हम सबके लिए एनर्जेटिक प्रेजेंटेशन थी, और क्योंकि सर बेनामी और इसके बारे में सुन के ही डर लगता था, हालांकि अनजाने में काफी ट्रांजेक्शन शायद हो चुकी होंगी सभी से, तो अब धीरे धीरे सोचने पर सब मजबूर हो गए सर। जी सर, आप एक क्वेश्चन का आंसर दे रहे थे कि जो पहले हो चुका है शायद उसको तो हम नहीं ठीक कर पाए, आगे के लिए सर कुछ सजेशन देंगे सर। जी
देखो, अब ये बहुत अच्छा सवाल है आपका, और मैं सभी अपने प्रोफेशनल ब्रदर सिस्टर से बात करना चाहता हूँ कि क्लाइंट हमारे पे काफी कुछ फेथ करता है, काफी डिपेंडेंट रहता है, तो सभी क्लाइंट्स को गाइड किया जाए कि कोई भी आप वो प्रॉपर्टी खरीदने लगे तो उसको ढंग से चेक करना है कि उस पर कहीं 24/7 का नोटिस तो नहीं आया, कहीं कोई बेनामी तो नहीं है, तो जो उसके जिसके नाम से रजिस्टर्ड है वही पर्सन सामने आ रहा है, मतलब अगर रजिस्टर्ड तो एक्स के नाम से है, डील कोई और कर रहा है, तो अगर ऐसा होगा डील कोई और कर रहा होगा तो इसका मतलब कुछ ना कुछ बेनामी एंगल है, तो अदरवाइज बेनामी एंगल है तो फिर कुछ ना कुछ चेक करना पड़ेगा। तो मेरे ख्याल से यही तरीका है कि हम चेक करें कि वो क्लाइंट बेनामी ना ले रहा हो प्रॉपर्टी, एटलीस्ट खुद के लिए और फैमिली के लिए तो बिल्कुल सजग रहें कि कोई भी प्रॉपर्टी बेनामी ना ली जाए, आगे के लिए ये ध्यान रखना पड़ेगा।
तो सर इसका मतलब जैसे आप बेनामी में तो सर ये चीजें चलो हमारा मार्गदर्शन करेगी, और जो प्रोसीड्स ऑफ क्राइम मनी है सर, जैसे आपने भी बताया मनी लॉन्ड्रिंग में, तो सर जैसे मान लो कोई क्लाइंट आता है और उसके अकाउंट में सर पैसा डिपॉजिट है, तो हमें जैसे क्लाइंट से सारी इन्फॉर्मेशन, कई बार वो हर इन्फॉर्मेशन हमारे को डिस्क्लोज नहीं करता है सर, तो हमें किस तरीके से पता चलेगा कि ये प्रोसीड्स ऑफ क्राइम मनी है जो इसने अपने अकाउंट में डिपॉजिट करवाई है?
ये अपने आप में एक बहुत बड़ा सवाल है, लेकिन अगर हम छोटा सा भी इंटरव्यू करते हैं तो उससे कुछ ना कुछ अंदाजा हो जाता है कि उसके मनी कहाँ से आ रही है, कॉरस्पॉन्डिंग रिटर्न्स उसकी क्या है, कॉरस्पॉन्डिंग बैंक अकाउंट क्या है, क्या एक्टिविटीज है, वो हम चार्टर्ड अकाउंटेंट्स आई थिंक इतने सजग, इतने क्षमता है हमारे अंदर दैट इफ यू अप्लाई लिटिल बिट ऑफ इंटेलिजेंस एंड इंटेलेक्ट वी हैव फ्रॉम आवर ट्रेनिंग एंड एवरीथिंग एक्सपीरियंस, सो वी आर एबल टू गेस समथिंग। दो दिस इशू इज राइटली रेज बिकॉज द गवर्नमेंट शुड कम आउट विद सम मैकेनिज्म so that the innocent people are not disturbed.
Okay, sir, ek question hai bhi Ajay Verma ji ka, C. Ajay Verma. Sir, if loan taken from sister-in-law, unsecured without interest and person buy share, is it Benami?
No, there is nothing to do Benami in this. Benami comes into play only when something is known in somebody's name and it is does not exist actually. So, प्रॉब्लम वही आती है, प्रॉब्लम लोन अगर एक्सप्लेन नहीं कर पाएंगे तो सेक्शन 68 और 69 का केस है, इसी लोन ले लेने से बेनामी हो जाता, चाहे वो इंटरेस्ट भी हो चाहे वो नॉन इंटरेस्ट हो, कुछ भी हो, दैट डज नॉट मेक अ डिफरेंस।
इन्हीं का ही सर नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन है, एंड व्हाट वुड बी केस इफ अनसिक्योर्ड लोन टेकन फ्रॉम वाइफ एंड डू सेम?
नो, एज आई सेड, मेयर टेकिंग ऑफ लोन विल नॉट मेक इट बेनामी, बेनामी विल कम इनटू प्ले ओनली व्हेन दैट देयर इज अ ड्यूअलिटी इन द ओनरशिप कांसेप्ट। सो इफ लोन सोर्सेज आर नॉट एक्सप्लेन्ड, then there is a different thing that may be a matter of under income tax law, but not here under Benami law.
और नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन सर, एंड काइंडली सजेस्ट अ बुक ऑन बेनामी लॉ. रामनाथ मोरे जी पूछ रहे हैं.
अभी तो सर एक्ट ही है, हम तो एक्ट से ही पढ़ रहे हैं, एक्ट से पढ़ते हैं. प्लस आई हैव रिटन सम आर्टिकल्स जो पब्लिश हुए हैं इकोनॉमिक टाइम्स में या itonline.org पर या टैक्समैन में. आई कैन शेयर दोज आर्टिकल्स विद यू इफ इट कैन बी कुड बी ऑफ एनी यूज टू एनी मेंबर्स. सो सारे आर्टिकल्स मैं भेज दूंगा आपके पास, तो वो आर्टिकल्स पढ़ सकते हैं, एक्ट पढ़ सकते हैं. टैक्समैन की एक बुक आती है लेकिन उसमें कोई बहुत अभी कोई विस्तृत कमेंट्री नहीं है उसके अंदर.
Whether it is connected with IBC 2016 in any way, Rakesh Ahuja ji.
No, IBC is totally different. Only the year of publication is same. IBC 2016 is different and PBPT Act 2016, which is the Amendment Act only. Original Act is 1988 only.
Okay.
Suresh
ji, over to you, sir.
Thank you, Bhupendra ji. So, आज के सेशन बहुत वंडरफुल रहा. तो मैं आशा करता हूँ कि सभी मेंबर्स का इसमें जो बेनामी एक्ट में है, क्योंकि सबके साथ ही ये प्रॉब्लम आने वाली है कि किसी ना किसी क्लाइंट को कोई ना कोई नोटिस भी जरूर आएगा, क्योंकि ये एक्ट भी इतना अपने आप में बहुत बड़ा रिस्पेक्ट लिए हुए है के लिए. तो मैं आशा करता हूँ कि इससे आपको सभी को काफ़ी नॉलेज मिली होगी कम से कम कि आगे कैसे प्रिपेयर करें, इसको कैसे हैंडल करना है. तो आज के जो हमारे मेन स्पीकर थे अश्विनी जी, इन्होंने बड़ा डीपली बड़ा आराम से समझाया सबको. तो मेरे को लगता है कि सब कुछ आपके माइंड में सेट हो चुका होगा कि इसको कैसे करना है और इसको कैसे जवाब देना है. तो मैं अश्विनी तनेजा जी का बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद करता हूँ कि आपने अपना कीमती समय पानीपत बराज को दिया. तो मैं सभी मेम्बर्स का भी बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद करता हूँ. वो हैव लिसन पेशेंटली दिस आर्टिकल. थैंक यू.
और हमारे लिए ब्लेसिंग है. और एक ITAT लेवल एक पर्सन से हमारी जब बात हो रही है तो बड़ा डिसेंट वे में, और आप इतने अच्छे तरीके से आपने सर हमने सभी समझाया और बड़ा टच अपन और एक क्यूरियोसिटी सी पैदा करी उनके अंदर और ये बताया गाइड करा कि हम किस तरीके से अपने क्लाइंट से इन्फॉर्मेशन जो है वो ले सकते हैं. तो सर हैट्स ऑफ टू यू सर. और बड़ा अच्छा देखिए सर, हिंदी और इंग्लिश का एक लैंग्वेज का जो इशू था, आपने ना इतनी अच्छी से इंग्लिश बोली है सर, मतलब प्यार से. और मैंने देखा सर इतने बड़े लेवल पहुँचने बाद इंग्लिश भी काफ़ी हाई फाई हो जाती है, तो आपने इंग्लिश के वर्ड इतनी सहजता से बोले, तो आई थिंक किसी को कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं आई सर. किसी को भी सिर्फ जो प्योर हिंदी नहीं सुन सकते उनको थोड़ी प्रॉब्लम आई थी. वो एक ही थे उनका वो रीज्वाइन हुए, उनको लगा कि अब तो कम्प्लीटली इंग्लिश में हो रहा है. तो आप सभी का सर बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद. और अश्विनी सर आपका आपसे रिक्वेस्ट है आज से ही और इसी प्लेटफॉर्म से कि हम आपको सर दोबारा पक्का इन्वाइट करेंगे, और जैसे ही हमारे चेयरमैन सर हमें परमिट करेंगे हम नेक्स्ट एक सीरीज शुरू करेंगे सर. तो आपने फिर से हमारे को तथास्तु कहना है सर. तो थैंक यू एवरीवन.
थैंक यू एवरीवन.
बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद सर. और कल हमारे साथ गिरीश आहूजा जी आ रहे हैं, तो काइंडली स्टे कनेक्टेड. और नहीं तो गिरीश जी तो और सुरेश सर, गिरीश जी ना सामने बैठते हो को डांट देते अगर कोई लेट के सुन रहे तो. तो थैंक यू वेरी मच सर. थैंक यू. बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद सर. आप सभी का बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद.
थैंक यू भूपेंद्र जी.